Good morning and welcome to St. Vincent. You'll be pleased to know that I'm not on the program, so my only duty is to extend a warm welcome to all of you and to indicate that this is co-sponsored by the Seminary and all the Seminary Education Foundation, and it's my pleasure now to introduce to you the president of the St. Benedict Education Foundation, Father Benoit.
Good morning and welcome to St. Vincent for the annual lecture of the St. Benedict Education Foundation, which supports San Anselm, the International Benedictine University in Rome. We are pleased today to welcome one of the most distinguished alumni of San Anselm, Archbishop Wilton Gregory, the Archbishop of Atlanta. Welcome, Archbishop.
Thank you, Benoit. Thank you.
I am also delighted to welcome our own Bishop, Bishop Lawrence Bryant, and the Bishop Emeritus of the Diocese of Erie, Bishop Donald Putnam. Welcome. Now it's my pleasure to introduce to you the Rector of St. Vincent's, the Rector Magnifico, Father Timothy Wall. Welcome.
Again, welcome to St. Vincent, and it is my privilege to introduce to you our local ordinary, the Diocesan Bishop of Greensburg, Bishop Lawrence Brandt. Bishop Brandt was ordained in 1969 at St. Peter's Basilica. He had a distinguished career with the Diplomatic Corps of the Vatican, serving in the nunciature at Madagascar and then in Bonn, Germany, where he was cited and awarded. He returned to the United States, became the full-time chancellor of the Diocese of Erie, and then was appointed the fourth bishop of the Diocese of Greensburg on January 2, 2004. And so we welcome our Bishop, Bishop Brandt.
Hey, Larry, how are you?
Good to see you.
Thank you.
Good morning. I have been asked to introduce another person, a moderator of what's called passing the buck. The moderator of our discussion today, and it's a distinct privilege for me to introduce him this morning as we begin our discussion of the liturgy and the new evangelization. And the moderator for our discussion is the recently retired Bishop of Erie, His Excellency Bishop Donald Troutman. I have been friends with Bishop Troutman since we both were students at the University of Innsbruck, Austria. He in the Faculty of Theology and I in the Faculty of Philosophy. For many years since that time, I have followed his career with affectionate respect and admiration. Bishop Troutman studied theology under Father Karl Rahner and the noted liturgist Father Joseph Jungmann in Innsbruck. Subsequently, he earned his licentiate in sacred scripture at the Biblicum in Rome and his doctorate in theology from the University of St. Thomas, likewise in Rome. In the Diocese of Buffalo, he had a wide range of pastoral, educational, and administrative experiences as a parish priest, seminary professor, chancellor, vicar general, and auxiliary bishop. In 1990, he was appointed the Bishop of Erie. As a member of the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops, the USCCB, he was elected to an unprecedented 2 terms, 6 years, as chairman of the United States Bishops Committee on Liturgy, and played a prominent role in translation issues relative to the lectionary and the new Roman Missal. He is also the former chairman of the Bishops' Committee on Doctrine. Bishop Troutman has been not only a diocesan bishop, but a national bishop as well. Notre Dame University Center of Pastoral pastoral liturgy, named Bishop Troutman a recipient of the Michael Mathis Award, its highest honor bestowed for outstanding contributions to liturgy. The Federation of Diocesan Liturgical Commissions annual Monsignor Frederick McManus Award was presented to him in 2003. He has been the recipient of several doctorates and also St. John's University with its highest recognition, its gold medal. Bishop Troutman has written extensively on liturgy and scripture, with numerous articles appearing in America and worship magazines. For over 25 years, he served as Episcopal moderator also of the Diocesan Financial Management Conference and was chairman of the Board of Trustees of Gannon University in Erie until his retirement this year. Bishop Troutman has also been an active member of the Pennsylvania Catholic Conference and is a member of the Board of Trustees of St. Mary's Seminary and University in Baltimore. In this exceptional plethora of roles and activities, Bishop Troutman has been an extraordinarily active bishop pastorally also in the Diocese of Erie. It is then for me truly a great pleasure to present to you our discussion moderator, Bishop Donald Troutman.
Bishop Brandt for that gracious introduction. We were co-workers for many years, and it's good to see the esteemed Bishop of Greensburg again. Thank you. The charism of this Benedictine community has been a great blessing of the Lord for His church, and in particular also for the Erie Diocese. So I want to thank the Archabbot, and I thank the St. Benedict Foundation, St. Vincent Seminary, for hosting this important lecture, commemorating the Year of Faith, commemorating the 50th anniversary of Vatican II, and the 20th anniversary of the New Catechism. No topic is more vital, more contemporary, more needed, more pastorally urgent than liturgy and the new evangelization. To respond to the erosion of faith in our culture, we need a more profound understanding of the Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy. That conciliar document stated boldly, is the source and summit of church life. And so, church's worship should evoke full and active participation of all its members. The Council Fathers are very specific, stating, the Church in its doctrine, life, perpetuates and transmits to every generation all that the Church is, all that the Church believes. We can all nod our heads and say, great theory, great truth. But in practice, how do we ordain and non-ordain transmit the life of the church? What is the role of the liturgy in this transmission? We all know from our own experience, good liturgical celebrations foster and nourish faith. Poor celebrations may weaken faith. Full, conscious, and active participation in the liturgy will foster evangelization. We are blessed this morning in having a renowned and respected liturgical scholar and a dynamic pastoral leader, Archbishop Wilton Gregory, as our presenter. He is the gifted and graced leader of the Archdiocese of Atlanta for the past 7 years. A native of Chicago, he was ordained a priest in 1973, and 10 years later was ordained the auxiliary bishop of the Archdiocese of Chicago. After his ordination as priest, he served in parish ministry and then studied under the Benedictines in Rome at the Pontifical Liturgical Institute Sant'Anselmo. He earned his doctorate in sacred liturgy in 1980. He taught on the faculty of St. Mary of the Lake Major Seminary, served as master of ceremony for two cardinals, and after 11 years as auxiliary bishop, he became the diocesan bishop of Belleville, Illinois, where he served for 10 years. Pope John Paul II selected Bishop Wilton Gregory to become the Archbishop of Atlanta. The bishops of our country elected then Bishop Wilton Gregory to be the president of the United States Catholic Conference. He showed strong, decisive, and wise leadership as our president, especially in the Dallas meeting of the bishops, when the bishops addressed the sex abuse crisis and enacted the Charter for the Protection of Children and Young People. Thanks and praise to God for the vocation and leadership skills in the ministry of Wilton Gregory. But this morning, I want to pay public tribute to two nuns in Chicago who were instrumental in the life story of the Archbishop. Two activities went door to door asking African American parents to send to parish Catholic school, St. Carthage. Wilton and Ethel Gregory said yes, and young Wilton began as a nun Catholic at the Catholic grade school. Wilton fell in love with the Catholic Church and its liturgy, and the rest is history. Those two sisters, going house to house, knocking on doors, were evangelizers long before the term new evangelization was in anyone's vocabulary. God works in humble, hidden ways. May God reward those two nuns, and let us welcome the results of their evangelization as a liturgical scholar and dynamic church leader, Archbishop Wilton Gregory.
Thanks so much.
Blessings, blessings.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thanks to Bishop Troutman for that wonderful and kind introduction. Thanks, Bishop Brandt, for allowing me to visit the Diocese of Greensburg. Thanks especially to Archabbot Douglas for his always gracious welcome. And to all of the monks and members of St. Vincent Seminary and University, thank you for your gracious hospitality. And to all who are here to participate in this morning's session, especially my brother priests. The things that I may say today, while I think they're true, I hope they're true, I believe they're true, you have to put them in action. And in so many ways, we bishops can never thank our priests enough for their service and their dedication. So thank you for your gracious invitation to deliver this address on a topic which is so apropos to the precise moment that we find ourselves in the church today. Accepting the challenge to be engaged in the process commonly referred to as the new evangelization, by using that which believers have enacted since the first moments of the church, celebrating the liturgy as the very heritage and spiritual legacy of believers in Christ Jesus. What is the new evangelization? It is to preach the gospel anew in the Catholic tradition, to people who have grown lukewarm in their commitment to and who have distanced themselves from the practice of the faith. And given the release in early October last of the latest Pew study about the statistical numbers of Americans who profess no faith and belong to no church affiliation, we all have much work to do. 1 in 5 adults today say they have no formal religious affiliation, 20%. In the 1950s, that number was 2%. Evangelicals have declined from 21% to 19%. And mainline Protestants have declined from 18% to 15%. We Catholics have held our own numbers, but the story behind that figure is that our numbers stay high because of the immigrant, principally the Latino population, that is increasing. Nevertheless, it is a disturbing fact that 1 in 3 Catholics do sometime leave the church during the course of a year to join the nones, those who are spiritual but not religious, non-practicing Catholics. There is a silent erosion going on. Evangelization is what all Christians are asked to do: share and spread the good news. In the history of recent papal leadership, Pope Paul VI placed an emphasis on evangelization in the Catholic context, and it goes back to the Third Ordinary Synod in the fall of 1974 and the post-synodal apostolic exhortation Evangelii Nuntiandi. While a few years old now, the book by Avery Cardinal Dulles, Evangelization for the Third Millennium, which was published in 2009, he cites Pope Paul VI's encyclical. In typical, lucid, and careful prose, Cardinal Dulles articulates a dozen features of the Catholic new evangelization, one of which is liturgy and sacraments. Pope John Paul II, in his address to the Latin American bishops at Port-au-Prince, Haiti, in March 1983, coined the term new evangelization. In his apostolic letter about the third millennium, Novo Millennio Iniunte, Pope John Paul II spoke of the new evangelization in particular in relation to the proclamation of the word and at the document's conclusion. In June 2011, Pope Benedict XVI established the Vatican Pontifical Council to promote the new evangelization. He appointed Archbishop Rino Fisichella as the president of this new office. He had formerly been the rector of the Lateran University in Rome, where he taught fundamental theology, and he also taught the same at the Gregorian University. The Holy Father called for the recently completed Synod on the New Evangelization, which he attended daily. His homily at the opening Mass comments on opening day and on the final day and his homily at the closing Mass, and they are particular examples of his characteristically theologically fine-tuned approach to evangelization. There were discussions among the cardinals in February of this year, and which was introduced by an address to them by the then newly designated Timothy Cardinal Dolan. In the documents preparing for the Synod, from the General Secretariat for the Synod of Bishops in the Lineamenta, which was issued February 2011, and in the Instrumentum Laboris, which was issued in June of 2012, the pre-Synod written critiques and submissions from bishops, conferences, and individual bishops also spoke frequently of the relationship between the new evangelization and liturgy. Since the lineamenta and the instrumentum laboris are public documents, they generated a great deal of discussion outside of these official documents and official channels. The opening remarks of Cardinal World, it was reported that he spoke from anywhere between 45 minutes to an hour in Latin, so you are spared this morning. And the bishops and the auditors who spoke from 5 to 6 minutes each. The USA delegates, Senate delegates, included Cardinal Dolan, Archbishop Joseph Kurtz of Louisville, Archbishop Jose Gomez of Los Angeles, Archbishop Garcia Sillier of San Antonio, and Bishop Gerald Cacanus of Tucson, were joined by the USA advisors to the Senate, Sister Sarah Butler, Dr. Michael Martin, Edward Peters, and one of your own Benedictines, Father Jeremy Driscoll of San Anselmo and Mount Angel in Oregon. The discussions around the topics of the Senate occurred most evenings. Of all the documents to emanate from the Senate thus far, I judge the most important to be the final propositions voted on by the Senate Fathers and then consigned to the Holy Father, Pope Benedict. The final word on the Senate will come in about 18 months if the ordinary time frame is followed, with the customary post-synodal exhortation on the topic, in line with many other post-synodal exhortations. For example, Pastores Dabo Vobis, Sacramentum Caritatis, and Verbum Domini. In point of fact, this kind of document is relatively recent, given that international synods began to be held after the Second Vatican Council. Of particular interest to theologians is what is the relative weight of this document in relation to council documents, with their hierarchy of constitution, decrees, and declarations, and the fact that it is a collaborative effort of bishops in synod with the Holy Father himself. Some have particular staying power, for example, the formation of priests and the four pillars of formation to be found in Pastores Dabo Vobis, which has shaped the present approach to priestly formation here and in seminaries all over the world. Some are very focused, for example, Sacramentum Caritatis on the Eucharist and Verbum Domini on the Word of God. As the Catholic Church launches into these uncharted waters of the new evangelization, I have often asked myself the question, what is specifically Catholic about the new evangelization, given that we share the same cultural contexts and decline in membership with other churches? Or to put it differently, what do we Catholics bring to the table when it comes to moving from conference desk, classroom, and pulpit to do what the risen Lord asked his disciples to do, to go forth to preach and teach all that he had commanded us to do in a way that reflects the genius, the breadth, and the depth of the Catholic tradition? In the end, one of the most important answers to this question is the role of liturgy and sacraments in the new evangelization. Allow me to begin this section of my presentation with a comment on the Senate process. From the issuance of the lineamenta in February 2011 through the instrumentum laboris last Pentecost Sunday, I had been particularly attentive to the way that these documents dealt with the liturgy. From my perspective, the lineamenta was strong about the value of preaching at the liturgy, but it said little else about the liturgy. The instrumentum laboris was much more deferential about the liturgy, but from my perspective, the descriptions were still somewhat sketchy. Having myself been a delegate at three different synods, the 10th Ordinary Synod on the bishop servant of the gospel of Jesus Christ for the hope of the world in 2010, and the 11th the Eucharist, or 2001, the 11th, the Eucharist, source and summit of the life and mission of the Church in 2005, and the second Synod for Africa, which took place in 2009. I can observe that synods are very much works in process. As I read summaries of the talks given on the Synod floor, I saw an evolution in the way the Synod Fathers appreciated the role of liturgy in the new evangelization. The final propositions say important things about the liturgy. I note in particular the following. First, among the most theologically rich propositions is number 4 on the Holy Trinity, source of the new evangelization, in which it states, evangelization has to be understood in a broad and profound theological doctrinal framework as an activity of word and sacrament, which, especially through the Eucharist, admits us to participation in the life of the Trinity. My own sense is that this tersely worded set of assertions can help to contextualize and explain why active participation in the sacred liturgy was one of the primary goals of the liturgical reform initiated 50 years ago at the Second Vatican Council. Our engagement in the liturgy is for the sake of our deification, our being made like God, and our abiding in the Trinity. I am reminded here of St. Paul's speech on the Areopagus in the Acts of the Apostles, whose memorable phrase is recounted in Sunday preface number 6. For in you we live and move and have our being. That is why the liturgy is so important. It is our privileged experience of nothing less than the life of the Trinity. The proposition which addresses the primacy of God's grace and how in baptism one comes to live in Christ. These texts are rich in helping us to appreciate the theology of what the liturgy is and what the liturgy does. Second, in the most complete description of the liturgy in general, the final proposition states in number 35, the worthy celebration of the sacred liturgy, God's most treasured gift to us, is the source of the highest expression of our life in Christ. It is therefore the primary and most powerful expression of the new evangelization. God desires to manifest the incomparable beauty of his immeasurable and unceasing love for us through the sacred liturgy. And we, for our part, desire to employ what is most beautiful in our worship of God in response to his gift. In the marvelous exchange of the sacred liturgy, by which heaven descends to earth, salvation is at hand, calling forth repentance and conversion of heart. Evangelization in the church calls for a liturgy that lifts the hearts of men and women to God. The liturgy is not just a human action, but an encounter with God, which leads to contemplation and deepening friendship with God. In this sense, the liturgy of the church is the best school of faith. Again, I see this as an important reiteration of the value of the sacred liturgy as the source and summit of the Catholic Christian life. Of particular note, it seems to me, is the emphasis placed on beauty here as well as in paragraph 20 with its direct admonition that education in beauty should not be neglected, nor education in the sacred arts, in seminaries specifically. It goes on to say that it is necessary that the church be vigilant in caring for and promoting the quality of the arts that is permitted in the sacred spaces reserved for liturgical celebrations, guarding both its beauty and the truthfulness of its expressions. These assertions also hit at a particularly Catholic characteristic, namely our historical tradition of fostering the arts and the initiatives of recent popes in this regard. I am thinking here of Pope Paul VI's patronage, especially of modern art. Pope John Paul II's letter to artists issued in 1999 in the context of his highly philosophical approach to beauty. And finally, Pope Benedict's repeated addressing the beauty of creation and how beauty can lead us to the truth that is God. A number of corollaries occur to me as I reflect on these important paragraphs. The first is that the celebration of the liturgy is and ought to be an act of beauty, with each and every aspect of it seen as sacramental, meaning, among other things, that they all reveal and reflect the living God through the things of and from creation, as well as the works of human hands. My own sense is that we need to spend more attention to the sacramental and incarnational principles on which the liturgy is based in our catechesis on the liturgy. The sacramental principle is that we use the things of this world to worship God, and that in using them, we show how we Catholics value and revere the world in which we live. The incarnational principle is that we use our bodies in the act of liturgy, which again shows a Catholic reverence for our bodies. That is why we must say that the pithy phrase, "say the black, do the red," may be humorous on one level, but it flies in the face of the decided shift towards the ars celebrandi in recent Vatican documents to describe the way the liturgy is to be conducted. The presiding priest's gestures, postures, and invitational stance go a long way toward allowing the power of the sacred liturgy to engage imaginations and hearts, as well as our minds. The second issue these texts raise for me is the importance of the creativity of artists in our and in every generation of the Catholic Church's life. As one who reviews plans for church buildings and renovations, I am especially delighted when those plans contain new works of art, crafted by artists of our own time, whose creativity and skills are to be valued and revered. I am concerned when some plans rely on what I call catalog art, of artifacts already produced in mass quantities aimed at generic liturgical or devotional spaces. I am also concerned that artificial, that is, plastic materials, are used in worship spaces and in sanctuary decor when what is natural or taken from the world of nature should be presumed. This is to suggest that each and every thing we use in the liturgy, from vessels and vesture to water, oil, chrism, bread and wine, ought to be seen as reflective of God's handiwork in creation and the human's ingenuity and craftsmanship in designing them. The third issue that these texts raise for me is where and how the tradition of Catholic art and artistry is taught in our university and college curricula, not to mention the direction in this document about education in seminaries. In his final press conference at the end of the Synod, Cardinal Wuerl commented on the role of beauty in the new evangelization, and said that the experience of being in Rome for the Synod reminded the Synod Fathers of the interrelationship of beauty and culture in the Eternal City itself. I could not but think back to the time of my graduate studies in Rome under the tutelage of the Benedictines at Sant'Anselmo, as well as the incredible, literally, beauty that was reflected on every street and in every church building in Rome's city center. Education in the Catholic tradition should also be formation in the variety of styles of architecture and of schools of art created and designed as sacrificial offerings to be offered by men and women of a particular talent in every age of the church's life. My concern is where this breadth of the Catholic tradition is reflected in Catholic university and college curricula, as well as in priestly formation. Number 34 of the final propositions asserts that the Eucharist must be the source and summit of the new evangelization. It then goes on to suggest the tension between the Christian Sunday and the secular Sunday, offering Pope John Paul II's important document on the Lord's Day, Dies Domini, as a fruitful reflection on this important issue. Especially in our American culture today, we cannot rely on our culture to presume and support participation in Sunday worship. And this for a variety of reasons. The latest figures on American Catholic mass attendance indicate that about 30% of Catholics participate in Sunday Eucharist. Clearly, this needs to be a major effort of the new evangelization. Allow me here to comment on the quality of our liturgies and the sense of belonging which ought to characterize participation in the Sunday Eucharist. In 2001, the University of Notre Dame published a book entitled Young Adult Catholics, which summarized a survey of Latino and non-Latino Catholics from late teens through the age of 30. The findings reflect a number of other such studies, like those conducted by Dr. William Antonio and his team from the Catholic University of America. For these young adults, the Eucharist stands as the highest identifying characteristic of Catholic Church belonging. But increasingly, the quality of the liturgy was a major topic in young adult Catholics. They indicated that sources of dissatisfaction concern the quality of homilies, music, and hospitality. This does not surprise me, but what it points to is the way the effort we put into preparation for and the execution of our liturgies. All surveys of American priests since the Second Vatican Council indicate that their highest source of job satisfaction is the celebration of the liturgy and preaching. That there is a disconnect here seems obvious, and it is a disconnect with which the American bishops addressed in approving earlier this past month a new document on preaching at Mass entitled Preaching the Mystery of Faith, the Sunday Homily. I hope and pray that this document will be a rich source for all bishops, priests, and deacons as we continue to deepen our commitment to ever more effective preaching. With regard to music, I want to connect what I have already said about beauty and the Ars Celebrandi. My own sense is that good music for the liturgy is a major agenda item for many of us. And here it should be remarked that the post-Vatican II church has seen unprecedented and sometimes unrealistic expectations placed on our musicians. That today we might want to retire some tried and true music composed after Vatican II, and I'd like to retire it today, because it is trite, is a good thing. That liturgical celebrations are beautiful is often the result of the way liturgical ministers, including musicians, undertake their ministries with decorum, a faith commitment, and energy. That hospitality is an increasing value for American worshipers strikes me as on target, especially given the mobility of society reflected in the transience of many of our liturgical communities. Efforts at welcoming Sunday worshipers on the part of priests and staff members, along with creating places to gather before and after Masses, for example, the church plaza and the commons areas, are important so that people can make connections and can feel connected. While the Roman Catholic Church is the only religion I know of that has the audacity to divide the world into parishes, it is clear that the sense of belonging that could once be presumed by geography can no longer be presumed. People parish shop. And in many instances, it is the quality of the liturgy and the sense of belonging that matters most to them. Fourth, number 36 addresses the spiritual dimension of the new evangelization and notes that the contemplative dimension of the new evangelization is nourished continually through prayer, beginning with the liturgy, especially the Eucharist, source and summit of the life of the church. For me, this is a helpful reminder of the way Catholicism combines the liturgy with other kinds of prayer, and the way that Catholic spirituality finds its roots in the liturgy as supported by Lectio Divina, which was cited in the final proposition number 11, and in contemplation. In this regard, I found the ecumenical intervention of Rowan Williams, the outgoing Archbishop of Canterbury, and a daily participant in the Synod, to be extremely insightful and helpful. In an American culture where many characterize themselves as believers but not belongers, and as spiritual but not religious, I take the assertion in this proposition to be very helpful reminders of the both and dimension of Catholicism. Clearly, spirituality is on the minds and in the hearts of many in our society. What I would wish, however, is that our appreciation of spirituality include our deepened prayer lives, more earnest participation in the liturgy, and also a deepened commitment to the social doctrine of the church, which was referred to in the final proposition number 24. It seems to me that a chief characteristic of the way Catholics view and celebrate the liturgy is by respecting how it should shape how we look at life through the prism of the Paschal mystery, and how we live our lives in conformity with it. That the present Holy Father was very concerned about a possible disconnect between liturgy and life was evident in his personal intervention with additional forms of the dismissal rite at the Eucharist to underscore this intrinsic connection. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life. There is, it seems to me, a delicate balance among these three intrinsically interrelated realities: liturgy, contemplation, and action. It is a part of the Catholic genius. It deserves to be a major part of the Catholic new evangelization. That the final propositions also address the social teaching of the church in number 24 is important because this is one part of what I regard as the intrinsic relationship between liturgy and social doctrine, including its manifestation in action. Number 5. In the final proposition number 38, the Synod Fathers take up the issue of Christian initiation. My own sense is that among the major success stories of the implementation of the Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy is the way the seasons of Lent and Easter are characterized as the season for initiation and its renewal and reconciliation, and of the implementation for the order of the Christian initiation for adults. In fact, in his recently published book, From Advent to Pentecost, Comparing the seasons in the ordinary and extraordinary forms of the Roman Rite, the Benedictine monk professor Patrick Reagan will observe that this is one of the lasting and finest contributions of the ecology for the season of Lent in the Missal, as revived after the Second Vatican Council. Clearly, this order is the clearest example of the way a classical form of the liturgy has been adapted and adopted with great enthusiasm in the contemporary church, especially here in the United States. This is also the place where evangelization is noted as a necessary stage in Christian initiation leading to the other sacraments. The final proposition notes that the theological unity of the sacraments of initiation, and cites them, but also those that they are pastorally diverse. The Synod Fathers suggest that the practice should be evaluated in light of the post-synodal exhortation Sacramentum Caritatis, which places the Eucharist, and by implication and context, not confirmation, at the center and goal of the whole process. Put differently, the question now is, what is said theologically about the sacraments of Christian initiation when confirmation is the last of these sacraments to be received, and especially when the sacrament is administered in high school? When confirmation is thus delayed, does it not become the goal? In addition, there is the related question of the preparation for confirmation and its requirements. Do these legitimate pastoral strategies sometimes take a life of their own and invite one to view the sacrament as something earned, which of course is the furthest thing from what liturgy and sacraments are, signs of God's continuing invitational love and graciousness to which we are to respond? Archbishop Sam Akula, when he was the bishop in Fargo in North Dakota, restored the traditional order of baptism, confirmation, Eucharist, for which he received a special acknowledgement by Pope Benedict XVI during his ad limina visit to Rome this year. This same restoration has occurred in the dioceses of Portland, Maine, Phoenix, Arizona, and might I also add in Saginaw, Michigan, where the diocesan guidelines call for penance in the second grade, confirmation in the third grade, and first Eucharist in the fourth grade. Now, with a good number of parents here and grandparents, I don't want to start a war over this, but there is something to be said about restoring the sequence of the sacraments. However, it should also be noted that for the former prefect of the Congregation for the Doctrine of Faith, he also prefers a later age. My own sense is that we need to take the word maturity out of the discussion about confirmation, underscore its meaning as an initiation sacrament, and see Eucharist as the goal of Christian initiation. Number six, the new evangelization and the initial proclamation. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scripture, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. The Synod Fathers propose that guidelines of the initial proclamation of the Kerygma be written. This compendium would include a systematic teaching of the Kerygma in Scripture and tradition of the Catholic Church, teachings and quotations from the missionary saints and martyrs in our Catholic history that would assist us in our pastoral challenges of today, and qualities and guidelines for the formation of Catholic evangelizers today. My own sense is that this needs to be put in dialogue with the pre-catechumenate process in the RCIA. Specifically, I'm wondering whether this call for written guidelines should be the second stage after welcoming inquirers and unstructured conversation about God, faith, their own faith journeys, and the role of the Catholic Church in that journey. I am thinking here of the comment made by my friend, the Archbishop of Dublin, Ireland, Dermot Martin, when he asserted that he judged Ireland to be well catechized, but insufficiently evangelized. This is about the new evangelization and putting that into a dynamic relationship with kerygma and catechesis. Number 7, among the pastoral challenges we face with baptized non-practicers is that for them the liturgy has become an occasional service. That is to say that what should be a staple of daily life and prayer, the liturgy, has become something which some of the baptized tap into on occasion, especially at Christmas, Easter, and special events in life, sacraments of initiation, marriage, funerals, etc. When this occurs, the liturgy simply cannot be sustained. Ideally, the post-Vatican II reform of the liturgy offered the daily celebration of the hours for parishes and not just monasteries and religious houses. Here I applaud the unofficial efforts to simplify the revised liturgy of the hours by publishers such as This Is the Day and Magnificat. These daily prayer formats help to do what the liturgy is meant to do and to be: daily engagements in scripturally based liturgical prayer. When available, daily Mass serves the same purpose and is indeed the daily bread of Catholic life. In addition, in fact, as the final propositions state in several places, that the liturgy, especially the Eucharist, is the summit and source of the Catholic Christian life, then I judge that this is to be supported along with other forms of prayer by regular engagement in Lectio Divina on the scripture readings for the day. One facet of Catholic liturgy is the structured proclamation of the scriptures. One reason for this is so that we do not pick and choose our favorite texts, but that we conform ourselves to the church's wisdom in a lectionary system that invites reflection on numberless texts which proclaim the paradoxical nature of God's ways and God's will. Without regular engagement in the liturgy, in its many forms, in prayer and lectio, I am afraid that pre-marriage preparation can become a time for not illegitimate evangelization. And I wonder how much of that will take deep root given the cultural pressures on couples who are being married today. Obviously, your monastic witness here in fidelity to the hours is an indescribable gift for the church. That many parishes offer the celebration of the evening prayer as part of their Advent and Lenten liturgical schedule is also to be applauded, as is the celebration of the hours at days of prayer and recollection. But the lingering issue for me is whether these thereby become occasional services rather than a daily, regular, ritual engagement. That the monk in all of us could be so nurtured by regular engagement in such prayer as formative and normative is a deep-seated hope. Is it a realistic goal? And if not, why not, given the theological, pastoral, and spiritual priority of the liturgy in Catholic life? Finally, the question of silence. I suspect that I was not the only one who was as surprised as I was when Pope Benedict XVI chose the theme of silence and word, path to evangelization, to mark the 46th annual Vatican-sponsored World Communications Day this past May in 2012. It seemed at least counterintuitive, if not a downright surprise. Silence for communications? But then again, that is the genius of this Holy Father, to offer keen insight about communications, receptivity, listening, and silence, as well as speaking. This dynamic underlies all dialogue. This dynamic underlies all liturgy. That recent attention has been given to the Ars Celebrandi of the liturgy to include silence is only to be welcomed as part and parcel of our worship. My own sense is that part of the reason why the worship of the Eucharist outside of Mass and other Eucharistic devotions have taken hold, especially among the young, is their felt need for silence. While the following might be an oversimplification, I judge that there is merit in the following assertions about the pre-Vatican II liturgy. The Vatican II liturgy was largely, the pre-Vatican II liturgy was largely silent, with the assembly watching and reading along with hand missals and occasionally singing. Whereas devotions in churches on other days of the week offered the assembly the opportunity to participate actively by saying prayers in the vernacular and singing Tantum Ergo in Latin and by heart to accompanying benediction. In the Reformed liturgy, active participation is to be presumed, admittedly, with silences. But the felt need is now for silence at devotion and before the reserved sacrament. My own sense is that liturgy cannot be expected to say and do everything. That it leads us to silence before and in the unutterable mystery of God is a major goal. Without that goal, overly energetic and pre-programmed outcomes from the liturgy misfire and do not respect its inherent multivalent character. Each and every liturgy unleashes unimaginable and unfathomable acts of God's power to work among us. And it is always amazing and confounding grace from God that heals, that strengthens, that sanctifies, and that makes us holy. That is its nature. That is its genius. That is why it needs to be and is a privileged part of the Catholic new evangelization. Thank you very much.